everyone. My name is Esther. And before I further introduce myself, I would like to do something that we have not done so far in this conference. So just follow my lead and hopefully we'll all end up in the same spot after that. You guys are all separated chair-wise. Nobody's pushing on each other. So first of all, go ahead, stand up. Lift your hands up and stretch. And take a deep breath in and deep breath out. And then put your hands down and sit back. And now I will ask you to close your eyes and take a very deep breath, which you feel from the bottom of your stomach going up through your nose into your head, and then really slowly, while not thinking about my voice. When you're done, open your eyes and we'll continue. So, I am not a developer, and standing here in front of you makes me really, really, really nervous. I have been dreaming all night about bits and pieces of my code in this presentation. Not sure of how to start, how to continue, what to say. And I decided that I'm just going to say what I have to say, and you can take out of it what you want. I listened to the keynote this morning, and Greg said that we need to rehuman. So this talk is going to help with rehumaning yourself, changing yourself, making yourself a better person. I'm a family nurse practitioner. I work in different spheres. I work in primary care, I work in pain management, and I also work in addiction medicine. I also am doing my post-master's in psych. So, as we said, I am a full-staff nurse practitioner at this point. Some topics that we're going to cover are common issues and concerns with our legacy codes, which is us. What those issues are going to cause us if we don't take care of them, and how to refactor them one by one, all together, whichever way you want. I'm also going to give a couple of ideas for refactoring. So how do you all feel right now? Anybody happy? Lift your hands. Good. Sad? That's good. Anxious? Hungry? I'm going to get there in like half an hour. In pain? Okay. Mad? Good. Ambivalent?
Okay. All of the above.
All right. Sounds good. So remember this slide later. My husband, who's a developer, told me that you guys are going to get a kick out of this. I personally have no understanding of what it says. But what this means to me is that we're all people, we're all human, we're all prone to different issues, different health concerns, and if we don't take care of ourselves in a timely manner, those issues can become very, very difficult to change, and then can cause a lot of other problems. So let's write some failing tests. I'm a queen of writing failing tests, and then I ask somebody else to fix them for me. We have sleep, we have eating habits and everything that they cause, we have alcohol, we have body aches and pains, and mood. The reason I chose those five is not because they're the only issues that we might encounter, but because they're one of the most common issues that we all encounter. You can relate to probably one of those statements, maybe to all of them. I know that I am definitely relating to the first one and definitely to the last one. So at any given moment, we can probably relate some of those, if not more. So let's discuss all of those failed tests and some of the potential reasons for those tests to fail. also make you feel older. And we all need about 7.5 to 8 hours of sleep at night. When you're asleep, your body rejuvenates. There's a lot of processes that take part when you're asleep, so that the next day you wake up and you can continue with your work, continue with your life, and you do not even know that those processes are happening. For you, you're just asleep. Those processes include fighting infection, your nervous system rejuvenates, your body fights to regulate heat and cold intolerance, your blood sugar is regulated, your blood pressure is regulated, and your muscles are also being more relaxed and healing processes take place. This sounds very, very, very difficult to do. So now let's talk about what happens when you are failing at sleep. You can make very simple mistakes such as dropping your favorite ice cream after waiting for it the whole day. Or you can also make more serious mistakes like forgetting to go to work or forgetting to which work you're going to. And that happens to me a couple of days ago when I went almost halfway to one of my jobs, which wasn't really the place I was supposed to be. You can also lose focus. You have difficulty concentrating. You cannot perform easy tasks that before were very, very easy, and now you might need assistance from other people to perform. You also might get fired because you jeopardized yourself, and you can make a lot of mistakes on the road that then can jeopardize other people. And also squirrel, because you then can get distracted very easily. Next concern is diet. We all tend to eat whatever we feel like, because we have that availability. We have that $4 burger that we can buy, which is much easier than going to the store and making ourselves a salad. Sometimes we have cultural concerns that cause us to eat certain things as opposed to others. Sometimes we're just bored. I do not know about that. And sometimes we have a lot of stress and anxiety. We might be depressed, we might be happy, and then we start eating pretty much at any given moment of the day. There are some studies that correlate diet and lack of sleep, and those studies show that when we don't sleep well, we cannot regulate our desire to eat. We then start eating things that we shouldn't be eating, and they're definitely not going to be a carrot stick. We're gonna go for that burger, we're gonna go for that pizza, we're gonna go for that extra helping of ice cream, and then we gain weight, and then we have other issues. Other research shows that we have a cannabinoid center in our brain that is very dissatisfied when we're lacking sleep. And in order to provide satisfaction to that center in the brain, we start eating as well. So it gives us a different type of satisfaction. So now you ate it, and you probably feel like you shouldn't have. Don't worry, one time is not gonna change anything. We do need all the food groups that are available. So don't start cutting different food groups because now you are afraid that you ate something and you shouldn't have. However, when different types of eating turn into habit, there are more chances to develop such diseases as high blood pressure, high blood sugar, high cholesterol, and then your mood becomes very fluctuating in origin, and your productivity goes down. So let's talk about alcohol. I have a good representation of some of the types I personally like, but I didn't say that here as a health professional. With alcohol, there's a lot of reasons why people tend to drink. Sometimes they need to de-stress after a whole day of work. Sometimes it helps them with the thinking process. Sometimes it's culturally related. For example, you come home and you just have to have that red wine with dinner because this is a part of your culture. And some people are predisposed to the need of drinking, which then is related to your brain chemistry. Some drinking facts, and I was toying with the idea of giving you this whole explanation about obsessed with the body. And then I said, never mind, they're going to run away. But I do want you to know that what you think is a drink is not really a drink. It's much less than that. So standard drink is 1.5 ounces of a shot, 12 ounces of a beer, and 5 ounces of wine. Now, in a show of hands, how many of you take and watch exactly 5 ounces of wine when you put it in your glass? Didn't think so. Exactly. So that means that we all drink usually much more than we should drink. And to make it even worse, women have many more problems because we're allowed to drink even less than men. So by default, if I drink already 2 glasses of wine, I'm way beyond what I should ever drink. The other problem is that alcohol eliminates at a steady rate, and it has a steady half-life. So it really does not matter if you drink only one drink or if you drink 10. They're all going to go as slow out of your body as one drink, which makes it very difficult, and it gives you consequences. So then the effects from the alcohol are noticed in all of our body. It goes through our stomachs, our livers, and it can even cause cancers and bone conditions. This slide, while I was in school, drove it home really seriously. So after your last drink, within 8 hours, you can develop anxiety, insomnia, nausea, and abdominal pain after the last drink. Mind you, doesn't matter if it was the last drink after 12 drinks or the last drink after just one drink. Within 1 to 3 days, you develop high blood pressure, increased body temperature, and then you might start fighting with your scrum master. Within 1 week, you can actually get to the favorite stage of hallucinations, fever, seizures, agitation, and if you don't take care of it in time, so now that we talked about alcohol, let's talk about body aches and pains. Now, I watch my husband, who's a developer, sitting in the computer night and day and night, and then he maybe goes to sleep, and then he sits at the computer day and night again. And it's painful for me to watch because I simply do not understand how he can do it. But this also comes with serious trouble, such as pain and discomfort. So, if you're sitting uncomfortably and for too many hours because you have an important deadline, or you just need to write out your next thought, or being on a roll, you can have aches and pains from continuous typing, from lack of exercise, and inappropriate support while you're trying to type. These are some of the issues and concerns that developers might encounter, and this is by far not encompassing. So we'll talk about refactoring them a little bit later. Now let's talk about mood. We're all moody, whether you like it or not. By moody, I mean we can be very happy, we can be very sad, we can be very angry, but we're just moody because we're people. A lot of things cause us to be moody. We can be very happy because our test week passed after refactoring. Or we got married, we had a birthday, we bought a new house. We can also be very sad because we kept making a lot of errors. And we had the death, which is like almost equal. And fighting with somebody important. And we can also have dietary pain, sleep, and health state issues that contribute us feeling some type of way. If any one of our systems in the body fails, it changes our mood dramatically. And then our productivity goes down as well. We also have lack of concentration. We have relationship issues. Our mood can change with the time of day. For example, this morning I woke up and I was really rearing to go, and as the time came to 4 o'clock, now I'm agitated, anxious, nervous, and trust me, at about 5 I'll be very, very happy. So it all depends on the time of day, and you can correlate
will definitely change throughout the day. Physical activity or lack of helps and doesn't help, because before exercise you're probably moody, and after exercise you're also moody. What we ate or didn't affects your mood. So now that we talked about all the things that can go wrong, let's figure out how to make them do a better job for us and feeling good. So the way to get started is to quit talking and begin doing. We all like to talk about things, and we have a lot of well-wishers that tell us how to do things. We start going into diets, we start going into different fads, and this seems to be working for us pretty well initially. And then we say, yes, we made it, we stop, and all of a sudden we go right back to where we were. So I am a proponent of the more desirable approach, doing everything slowly, making sure that it works, not killing yourself in the process, and changing it as you go. So only you know what your bad state or good state is. I can talk to you until I'm blue in the face and tell you what you need to do and how you need to do it, but you are the master of your body, and you know what will make you feel good and what your good is. You have to make goals for yourself. You need to know what it is that you want to change. Some people want to change their sleep. Some people want to change their eating, exercise, work ethic, you name it. Sometimes you just want a combination of all of those. You are all different. Your legacy code is different than mine, than your friends, than anybody else's. If you want to change your legacy code, you need to concentrate only on yourself. People can give you a lot of advice that worked for them, but unfortunately, nod, say thank you, and continue in your own path, because what worked for them is probably not going to work for you. The most important part of it, everybody has a breaking point. So know that you will break, and it's a normal human process. If you're going to break, the only thing that you need to know is get up and continue and retry. Because if you fall and do not retry, you're just going to stay there. But give yourself a pat on the back, tell yourself, hey, I'm human, and just continue retrying from where you stopped. So we'll go through assessment. Wake up in the morning, ask yourself how I'm feeling, what's going on? Am I hungry, tired, upset? If I felt that way before, do I know what caused it? Go back, see what you did last night. What did you eat before you went to bed? How late did you go to bed? Did you drink? Water, not alcohol, water. And check the goals for today. Do you have something new that you have to do? Or are you just going to be doing something mundane that doesn't require too much brain cells? And then you need to diagnose. Any that, just an educated guess. The biggest thing is, common diseases occur commonly. And I heard that in one of the presentations when I was studying for my boards. Because as healthcare professional, to me, I'm jumping right away into the worst thing. Oh my God, I have cancer, I'm gonna die tomorrow, this is gonna be the end of my life, that's it. Not true, most of the time. But 99% of the time, you're probably experiencing something that somebody else right before you and after you will experience. So don't jump into conclusions that this is the end of the line. We cannot change everything at the same time. A lot of us fail when we try to change something because, first of all, we anticipate very quick results, and second of all, we try to change everything in a bunch. Then we do not know what failed. We do not know how to go further. And certain changes are going to take more time than others. So don't be afraid of that. Just continue with it. And changes when the previous changes are going well for you, when you understand that those changes actually worked. Don't add anything until you're comfortable with the previous change. So let's refactor sleep. How many people actually have 8 hours of sleep every night here? Wow. That's impressive. 2.5? Okay. So, exercise. If your wake-up time has to stay the same every morning, I getting to that time to go to bed. For example, if your wake-up time is 7 a.m. and you go to bed at 2 a.m., that doesn't work. So tonight you're gonna go to bed at 1:45 a.m., the next day at 1:30 a.m., and then you're gonna continue going to bed earlier and earlier and earlier until you reach that midnight, 11:30 p.m. ish, that is gonna be a good time for you to sleep. Take a walk before bed, drink something warm. Again, this alcohol is creeping up, not alcohol. And don't eat heavy meals before bedtime. And you are allowed to have a little snack. By snack, I don't mean ice cream or that last piece of pizza in your refrigerator. No screens in the bedroom, please, people. This is gonna ruin your sleep. All those computers, all those phones in the bedroom, this blue light actually takes away your melatonin and tells your brain that you are now wide awake, so you will not be able to go to sleep. So if you have anything important, check a couple of hours before. After that, leave it for the next day. With diet, we all need the food groups without omitting anything. However, if you have any medical concerns, do talk to your primary care provider and see, because you might be benefiting from certain foods that are gonna help you with your weight, with your health, with whatever. Aches and pains. Go and talk to whoever you need to talk to. Change your desk. Make sure that you have a wrist support. Make sure you have a different chair. Standing desk is always really nice because then you can stand up and work for a little bit and then sit down. Take a walk every hour. Stretch every hour. Drink at least, and by that I mean this is the most minimum, and then after that you would need to increase the amount of water daily. Exercise at least 3 times a week for 15 minutes. This is the minimum of the minimum. And if all fails, again, your primary care physician is your best answer. Refactor your mood. Now, I am very involved in a lot of things in my life. I have a very hard time detaching. I am working, I am a mother, I am a wife. I needed to think about it for a second. I also go to school, and I have a lot on my plate. I have a hard time delegating and telling somebody to do something for me. I just like it all done in a very certain way, not controlling at all. Which then brings my mood sometimes to be very, very awkward. And the people around me tend to suffer because of that. So think about deep breathing, about guided imagery, about meditation. Take a day off vacation. And even if you don't go anywhere, just sit at home on the couch and don't think about anything. And tell me how it went. Develop a hobby, and then again, with more serious issues, if you have any thoughts of hurting yourself or hurting anybody else, call 911 or go to the nearest ER. So here is a simple refactor. Now, this simple refactor, bless you, includes all of the subjects together. I personally just wrote it here as an example of different refactoring things that you can do with each one of the groups. I would suggest not doing it this way. I would suggest refactoring group by group, and then once you're comfortable with one group, ending the next one. So, if you would like to concentrate on only one of the groups, let's say you choose diet. I am a fan of my fitness pal, because if you don't fly to it, it actually gives you ideas about how to lower your intake. Now, if you lie to it, then unfortunately you're gonna stay the same way. But if you're honest and if you write everything that you need in this, it gives you a really good breakdown between your exercise, your calories, and what you need to do to either stay where you are, lower it, or increase it. If you choose to snack before bedtime, make sure that you have something that is less offensive, like a piece of apple, peanut butter. You can also have some other fruit, but try to stay away from if you choose to concentrate on sleep, here is an example of what you do every night. And once you're ready, about the fifth night, you can start combining both. The biggest thing is, this is not a rule of thumb. You can switch those days, you can do something else entirely, you can add some stuff. So you are the only one, again, that is gonna make a decision what works for you. The other thing is, if sometimes something doesn't work for you, doesn't mean that it will never work for you again. It just means that at this point in life, you need to choose something else. You need to be honest with yourself at how much you actually drink, if you do. The goal is to reduce your drinking to entirely not drinking throughout the week and possibly drinking only one alcoholic drink on the weekend. Good luck to everyone. See you later. I know that this is not realistic, and I know that we're all going to continue drinking. However, if drinking seriously becomes a problem, if it affects your work, if it affects your daily life, if it affects your concentration, or if it affects others, this is probably time to talk to somebody about it. If you choose to concentrate on your workplace, again, an example of several days worth of changes that then you can combine. And again, do everything slowly, see what fits. And if you still have aches and pains, go and talk to a professional. So, in conclusion, refactoring yourself will take some time and effort. You need to know what your goals are and not to kind of try to see what other people's goals are. Do not compare. Know that failing is an option as long as you continue trying to get up and moving along.